B'siyata d'shmaya, we're going to learn Yuma Daf Hey. We're going to start 6 lines from the bottom of Daf Dalad Omud Beis. Says the Gemara, Mechlal de Tarvayhu Svira Lohu Miluim Kol Akosov Behen Ma'akiv Bohen. And this takes us back to a sugya we learned previously, that on Daf Beis we already saw that Rabbi Yochanan learns that from the fact that there were 7 days of Prisha by the Miluim, that means before the first day where Aaron HaKohen started doing the Avod in the Mishkan, which was Rosh Chodesh Nisan, 7 days before that, he would separate himself, him and his children would separate themselves from their homes and come and stay in the Mishkan. And those were called the 7 days of Miluim. And we saw in the Pasuk that Rabbi Yochanan understood from the Pasuk that Kasha also b'yom hazeh tziva Hashem la'asis lechaper aleichem, that regarding Yom Kippur also and Paradumo, there was a chiyuv of Prisha. Rish Lakish, and this we saw at the bottom of Daf Gimel Amud Beis, Rish Lakish said to Rabbi Yochanan that since everything that it says, all the details that are listed by the Miluim are Ma'akav, we'll soon see why then where he knows that from, but it's Ma'akav, that means that it's not just a mitzvah to do lekatchila, rather that in the absence of these halachas, you've invalidated the avodah, invalidated what was supposed to be done during the Shivas Yimei Miluim. And therefore, Rish Lakish challenged Rabbi Yochanan, if so, if you learn Yom Kippur from the Miluim, then the Prisha that's required before Yom Kippur, every Yom Kippur, the Kohen Gadol would go to the Lishkas HaParedrin, which is the first Mishnah we learned on Daf Beis, should also be Ma'akev. And Rabbi Yochanan actually didn't answer Rish Lakish. It seems that he agrees with Rish Lakish that by Miluim, all the details are Ma'akev. And that's what the Gemara is saying now. Michlal, the Tarvayu Svira Luhu, both Rabbi Yochanan and Rish Lakish hold that Miluim, Kol HaKosov Behen, all the details listed in the parasha of Miluim, Ma'akev Behem are Ma'akev. The Itmar, we learned, and this was a different machleikus, a more general machleikus, not referring directly to the chiyuv of Prisha of separation, that Miluim, regarding all the mitzvahs and the details of the Miluim, Rabbi Yochanan, Rabbi Chanina, it was a machleikus, Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina, Chad Omar Kol HaKosov Behen Ma'akev Behen, one holds that all the details are Ma'akev, Chad Omar Dova Ma'akiv L'Doiris Ma'akiv Behen. Only those details that we find that are Ma'akiv, even generations later, they were also Ma'akiv then by the Miluim. But anything which was mentioned uniquely by the Miluim is not Ma'akiv. She'ein Ma'akiv L'Doiris, Ein Ma'akiv Behen. Those details that in later generations are not Ma'akiv were also not Ma'akiv then. And tis time, the Gemara says, I'll bring you proof that between Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina, which one holds that anything that was by the Miluim was Ma'akev. Tis time, proof is Rabbi Yochanan hu da Omar Kol HaKosov Behen Ma'akev Behen. Midakom alei, since we saw in the Gemara before that Rabbi Shimon ben Lakish to Rabbi Yochanan, Rabbi Shimon ben Lakish said to Rabbi Yochanan, Ima Miluim Kol HaKosov Behen Ma'akev Behen, that if you, Rabbi Yochanan, learn the Prisha by Yom Kippur from the Prisha of Miluim, then the same way as by Miluim it's Ma'akev, it should also be Ma'akev Yom Kippur. And Rabbi Yochanan didn't answer him and say, it's not Ma'akev. This time we have proof that Rabbi Yochanan agreed to Rish Lakish on this, that anything that it said in the parasha of Miluim was actually Ma'akev. And the Gemara already previously addressed how Rish Lakish knew that the Prisha by Yom Kippur is not Ma'akev. And that's what his question was. How can you learn the Prisha from Yom Kippur, of Yom Kippur, from the Prisha of Miluim, if by Miluim it was Ma'akev, and Yom Kippur it's not Ma'akev? Says the Gemara, May Binayu, what's the halachic difference or ramifications with this machlekas between Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina, whether things that are not Ma'akev L'Doiris, but are mentioned in the parasha of the Miluim, were they Ma'akev, were they not Ma'akev? That means the Gemara is now going to give us a list of halachas that are mentioned in the parasha of Miluim and are not Ma'akev in any other time, and that will be the machlekas between Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina, whether it was Ma'akev then. Omer Rav Yosef. Rav Yosef says, Smicha, the requirement to lean on the korban before shechting it, Ike binayu, that will be the machlekas. which is, and this smicha is actually mentioned explicitly in the parash of Miluim. So lemando amar kol hakosov ben makiv bohen smicha ma'akva. According to the opinion that everything it says in the parash of Miluim was ma'akiv, then it was ma'akiv. Lemando amar dovah she'ein ma'akiv v'deiris ein ma'akiv bohen. But the opinion who holds that anything that was not ma'akiv later on in the later generations was not ma'akiv by the Miluim, the smicha lo ma'akiv, then the smicha by the Miluim was also not ma'akiv. Says the Gemara, L'doiris minolon d'loi ma'akva. How do you know that smicha, leaning on the korban, even though it's a mitzvah, how do you know that if you don't do it, it's not ma'akva and the korban is still kosher and valid? Tatani, we learned in the Braisa. It says in the Pasuk, V'somach yodoi al roisha oilo, v'nirotzoloi lechapir olov. Says that V'somach yodoi, he would lean his hands on the head of the korban oilo, v'nirotzoloi, and then the korban would be accepted, lechapir olav, to atone for him. Asks the Gemara, v'chi, or the Braisa, v'chi, smicha mechaperes? Is, how can you say v'somach yodoi and then v'nirtzaloi lechapir olav, as if to say that it's the smicha that brings an atonement, v'aloyein kapora elo bedam? We know that atonement only comes due to the blood of the korban, not the leaning on the korban. How do we know that? Shnemer, it says in the Pasuk, ki hadam hu banefesh yechapir. The atonement comes from the blood, which carries the lifeline, the spirit of the animal. So how are you supposed to understand when it says in the Pasuk, V'somach yodel reish o'ilo v'nirtzaloi lechapir olav? What's the ritzui, the acceptance and the atonement got to do with the leaning? So says the Braisa, Shemaso l'smicha shiyori mitzvah. If you relate to the leaning, the mitzvah of leaning, as if it's just a shiori mitzvah, as if it's just the remnants of the mitzvah, as if it's something which is unimportant, and you don't do the smicha, then ma'alolav akosov, the pasuk views it, ki'ilu loy kipir. There was something lacking in the completion of the atonement. You didn't do what you were supposed to do in the best possible way. V'chipir, nonetheless, you do get atonement, because the avoidus that are done with the blood were done the way they were supposed to. So what do we see from here? We see from here clearly that the smicha is not ma'akev. And if you don't do the smicha, it's loy kippir v'kippir. It's not ma'akev. And that means that's regarding the smicha in all the generations. Regarding the miluim, that's the machloikas, Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina, whether it was ma'akev. That was the explanation of Rabbi Yosef. Rav Nachman by Yitzchak Omar, he says there's another halacha which is not ma'akev in later generations and is mentioned in the parasha of Miluim and would be a machlokes Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina. And what is that? Nachman by Yitzchak Omar, tnufa, it's the waving of certain parts of the korban where the Aaron and his children would wave those parts of the korban. It could be now that will be the machlekes. Lemando amar kol hakosov ben ma'akiv bohen ma'akva. Ulemando amar dovah she'ein ma'akiv v'deiris ein ma'akiv bohen loy ma'akva. It's mentioned in Miluim. So the opinion who says that everything mentioned is ma'akiv, it's ma'akiv. And those who say it's only ma'akiv if it's ma'akiv and later in deiris, it's not ma'akiv in later generations. Uledeiris minolon tole ma'akva. How do you know that in later generations, by the avoda, when there was a concept of waving parts of the korban, that it's not ma'akev? Again, from a braisa, the Tanya we learned in a braisa, that the pasuk says, litnufa lechaper. It says, v'imdalhu ve'in yodim maseges ve'lo kach keves echod osham litnufa lechaper olav, etc. So Gemara, the braisa asks, v'chitnufa mechaperes, is it the waving that brings atonement? As we saw before, same as we saw before. The reason that there's a relationship somehow between the waving and the atonement is not that it's ma'akev for the kapara. No, the tenufa is not ma'akev. It's just that there'll be something lacking in the quality of the atonement, because you didn't do the mitzvah in the best way. Because if you relate to the tenufa just as the remnants of a mitzvah and you don't do it, ma'ilolav akil hakosov, the pasuk views it ki'ilu loy kippir v'kippir, as if you didn't get the atonement in the best possible way, but you did get atonement because the atonement is not dependent on the tenufa. That's Rav Nachman by Yitzchak. Rav Papa Omar. Rav Papa says a different halacha. Prishas shiva ikabeinayu. When the separation of 7 days before Yom Kippur, for example, where the Kohen had to separate it himself 7 days before, was that Ma'akov? So in later generations before Yom Kippur, it wasn't Ma'akov. But the 7 days of separation mentioned by the Miluim, which according to Rabbi Yochanan is actually the source of this concept of separation, was in Ma'akov. That will be the Machlekes, Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina. If according to the opinion that says that anything mentioned in the parasha is Ma'akov, then it was Ma'akov. And according to the opinion who says that it's only Ma'akov, if it's Ma'akov in later generations, then it wasn't Ma'akov. Lemando Amar Kol HaKosov Ben Ma'akov Ben Ma'akva. Lemando Amar Dovah She'eini Ma'akov L'Doyrus Eini Ma'akov Ben Lo'i Ma'akva. U'L'Doyrus Minolon De'Lo'i Ma'akva. How do you know that in later generations the Prisha was not Ma'akov? Midakotoni. And this is actually the proof that the Gemara, the explanation that we saw before in the Gemara explaining Reish Lakish's question to Rabbi Yochanan, that in our Mishnah it says maskinin v'lo ktonim mafrishin, that they would prepare a second kohen to be in place of the kohen gadol in case the kohen gadol died, and it doesn't say that they would take that second kohen and also make him do a prisha, a separation, which means that if the first kohen would die, the second kohen would take his place and do the avodah on Yom Kippur, even though he hasn't done prisha. So you see that in later generations, the prisha needed by Yom Kippur is not Ma'akov. Continues the Gemara. Ravina Omar. Ravina says another halacha. Ribu yeshiva umeshicha shiva. What does that mean? When a kohen first became a kohen gadol, and the kohen gadol is referred to as a ribu yibegodim, we know that all the kohanim in the Beis HaMikdash, they wore four clothes of the big day kohana. A kohen gadol would have eight clothes. So, and there was a mitzvah that every time when a kohen gadol first became a kohen gadol, then for 7 days he would wear eight clothes and he would do the avodah for the first 7 days. And besides for that, meshicha shiva, they would put some of the shemen hamishcha, some of the oil, they would anoint this kohen on his head and between his eyes for seven consecutive days. And it's a mitzvah to do that. And this is mentioned too, also in the parish of Miluim. This is mentioned also in the parish of Miluim, and also generally there is such a mitzvah. And normally it's not Ma'akov, which means a kohen gadol, even if he didn't do the avodah for seven consecutive days, or he didn't get anointed for seven consecutive days, he's still a kosher kohen. As kosher kohen gadol, he can do the avodah. The question is, was it Ma'akov by the 7 days of Miluim? That's Ikar B'Nayu. That will depend on the machlekes Rabbi Yochanan and Reb Chanina. Lemando Amar Kol HaKosov Ben Ma'akov Ben Ma'akva. Lemando Amar Dovah She'ein Ma'akov L'Doyrus Ein Ma'akov Ben Lo'i Ma'akva. L'Doyrus Minolon De'Lo'i Ma'akva. How do you know that these two things that would, so to speak, be the inauguration of the Kohen Gadol, how do you know that in later generations it wasn't Ma'akov? The Tani we learned in the Braisa regarding Yom Kippur. What does it say by Yom Kippur? In Parsha Chremos, it says, V'chiper ha-kohen, the kohen gadol, who's going to be do the atonement, who's going to do the avodah, is the kohen gadol, asha yimshach oisoi, somebody who was anointed, v'asha yimali es yodoi, and somebody whose hands were filled, and yimali es yodoi means that he was wearing, he's a kohen who wears, his hands are full with eight big day kohuna, l'chahin tachas oviv, he was the one who was appointed when his father, probably the previous Kohen Gadol, passed away. V'lovash has big de'abod, big de'akodesh, etc. So the Gemara asks, Ma Talmud Loimar, why does the Posuk, what's the Posuk coming to teach us with this Posuk? Is it coming to teach us that the Kohen Gadol is the one who does the Avodah on Yom Kippur? If we already know that. It says that elsewhere, that it's Aaron HaKohen and his descendants, which means the Kohen Gadols who would do the Avodah on Yom Kippur. So why do I need this pasuk for? So lefi shenemar, because it says in the pasuk, and where's this pasuk? In the pasuk of Miluim, in the parash of Miluim, it says shivas yomim yilboshom hakoyin tachtov mibonov. That means the kohen gadol would wear the clothes. The Aaron hakoyin who would wear the eight clothes, and any kohen gadol after him would wear these clothes. Asher yavo el oil moed, the kohen gadol who comes into the oil moed on Yom Kippur l'shoris b'kodesh to do the avodah in the oil moed and in the kodesh hakodoshim, that kohen is the one that's going to, that is after Aaron HaKohen. So what does it say in the pasuk there? that shivas yomim yilbosho makoyin tachtov, that there's a mitzvah for the kohen gadol to wear the clothes and to do the avodah for 7 days when he's first inaugurated. Which kohen are we talking about? The kohen gadol who's yovel oil moed l'shores b'kodesh, who's going to go into the kodesh hakodashim on Yom Kippur. So the Gemara says, l'fish and emra, since it says in the pasuk shivas yomim yilboshom hakohen tachtov mibonov, so I may have thought only elon isra b'shiva, I may have thought that only somebody, a kohen who when he first became a kohen gadol he wore the clothes for 7 days, only he's the one who's yovel oil moed l'shores b'kodesh, he's allowed to do the avodah on Yom Kippur. V'nimshach shiva, and not only that he wore the clothes for 7 days, but also that he was anointed for 7 consecutive days when he became the kohen gadol. We'll soon see in the Gemara where that's alluded to in the pasuk. Nisra b'shiva v'nimshach yom echad. However, somebody who only wore the 8 clothes and did the avodah for 7 days, but he was not anointed for 7 days, or nisra b'yom echad, he wore the clothes and did the avodah 1 day, v'nimshach shiva, and he was anointed for 7 days, or nisra b'yom echad v'nimshach yom echad v'afilo shoachas. And what about somebody who only did the avodah just for an hour, or that he was only anointed once right at the beginning? Minayin, how do you know that he's still kosher to do the avodah siyom kippurim? Talmud lema, that's why it says in Parshas Acharei Mois, the pasuk we started with, Ashei Moshe v'chiper ha-kohen Ashei Moshe ha-chosei v'ashei male es yodo l'chayin tachas oviv. And from that pasuk we see, mikol mokim, as long as he did the avodah once at the beginning, as long as he was anointed once at the beginning, that's okay and it's not ma'akev. So from there you see that we have a special pasuk by Yom Kippur to say that even if he didn't do the mitzvah of doing the avodah for 7 days and being anointed for 7 days, it's not ma'akev. The question is, was it ma'akev by the miluim? And that's going to be the machlekes, Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina. Says the Gemara, Ashkechon ribu yeshiva lekatchila. Okay, we found a pasuk that says that you should, that a kohen, the first 7 days when he starts his avodah, he should wear the clothes and do the avodah. That's what we saw in the pasuk. Shivas yomim yilboshom kohen hakohen tachtov mibonov. Meshicho shiva lekatchila minolon. How do you know that lekatchila he should be anointed for 7 consecutive days? So the Gemara gives two suggestions. Ibo yisei mamid itzur krolim ute. Since when it comes to Yom Kippur, with that pasuk that says that Yom Kippur doesn't need 7 days, what does it say by Yom Kippur? That was the pasuk we saw. V'chipe hakohen ashe yimoshach oisoi. That both are mentioned there in the pasuk, that even if he was just anointed once and just did the avodah once, it's enough. So you see from there the fact that it says explicitly by Yom Kippur that once is enough, you see that the mitzvah, the lekatchila, is for 7 days. Another answer is the Omar Kra. The pasuk says, and this is one pasuk before the pasuk of Shivas Yomim Yilbosh HaMakoyin. It says there, Ubig de Akoidesh Ashele Aroin Yiu Levonov Acharov Lemosh Chobohem Ulemale Bames Yodov. So the pasuk compares Iskesh Meshicha, it compares being anointed with the oil, Leribui, to wearing the clothes and doing the Avodah. Ma Ribui Shiva Af Meshicha Shiva, in the same way as in the next pasuk it says Shivas Yomim Yilbosh HaMakoyin Tachtov Mibonov. So we assume that the Lemoshcho is also that he's anointed 7 consecutive days, Lekatchila, and whether it was Ma'akev or not by the Miluim is a Machlokes Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina. Whether it's Ma'akev in later generations, it's clearly not, as we saw in the Pasuk by Yom Kippur. Continues the Gemara. Mai tam demanda Omar kolakosov ben Ma'akev. We saw, and that's the beginning of our Shia today, Rabbi Yochanan and Rish Lakish both hold that anything it says in the parasha of Miluim was Ma'akev. What would be the source for that? Where do you see in the parasha of Miluim such a thing? And before we continue, it's important that we introduce something about the Miluim. And anyone who learns Chumash Rashi, will be aware of this. And if you don't, I highly encourage you to start learning Chumash Rashi every week. In the parasha of Miluim, it's actually mentioned twice in the Torah. We have in parashas Tetzaveh, in Shmois Perek Choftes, a whole perek, which is called Tzavah. This was the parasha where Hashem told Moshe everything that was supposed to happen in the 7 days before Rosh Chodesh Nisan, from Chof Gimel Adar till Chof Tes Adar. And then there's another parasha, in Parashas Tzav, in Vayikra Perikches, where there it's called the parasha of Asiya. That's where the Torah relates what actually happened. And there's it's almost completely parallel, and there are small nuances here and there, some differences. So the Gemara is now going to say, "My tam and demand omar kol kosu ben Makiv." What would be the source that anything it says in the parashiyos of Miluim Amakiv, Omer Bitzchok Bar Bisna, Omer Kro. Bitzchok Bar Bisna says that it says in parashiyos Tetzaveh, that's where the Tzivui was. What does it say there? In Pasuk Lamed Hei, V'asisa la'arin u'levonov kocho. You should do to Aaron and his sons, do it like this. Kocho ikuvahu. The fact that it says the word kocho is clearly teaching us it has to be done like this, and it's Makiv, according to that opinion. Says the Gemara, Tineich kol milsa t'chsiva b'hayin yona. That's all very good with anything mentioned in the parasha of Tetzaveh. The Tzavah, that's where Moshe Rabbeinu was commanded to do the whole, everything that was done by the Miluim. So since it says in that parasha, the end of that parasha, in Pasuk Lamed Hei, Kocho, it's Ma'akev. Milsa d'lo k'siva b'hayin yona. What about those things that are only mentioned in parashas Tzav, by the Asiya? And there it doesn't say Kocho. How do you know, Minolon, how do you know they are also Ma'akev? So here's going to be a few answers. Rav Nachman bar Yitzchok, Yalif, Pesach, Pesach. Rav Nachman bar Yitzchok says that since it says in the parashas Tetzaveh, it says Pesach Oel Moed, and since it says the same Pesach Oel Moed, it also says in the parashah of Tzav, so it's a Gzeira Shava. We learn Pesach, Pesach, in the same way as everything mentioned in parashas Tetzaveh is Ma'akev, so too everything mentioned in parashas Tzav is Ma'akev. Rav Masharshi Omar, Masharshi says, I don't need a Gzeira Shava, that in the same way as I have Kochor in Parashas Tetzaveh, I have a different word in Parashas Tzav. What does it say in Parashas Tzav? It says there, at the end, again, it also happens to be in Pasuk Lamed Hei, Ushmartem es Mishmeres Hashem, V'loisam Musu Kichein Tzuvesi, from the Ushmartem es Mishmeres Hashem, to guard and make sure that you do exactly what I tell you, from those words of Masharshia says, that we understand that anything it says in Parashas Tzav is also Ma'akev. Ravashi Omar, Ravashi says, Kichein Tzuvesi, Yikuva, from the fact that it says Kichein Tzuvesi in Parashas Tzav, that tells us that do exactly as I've commanded you and don't change, and that would be a source that it's Ma'akev. And now the Gemara says, since you learned from that Pasuk in Parashas Tzav, also Pasuk Lamed Hei, Kichein Tzuvesi, which would seem superfluous because we know that you've commanded us to do that because we see all the psukim. So the extra words, Kichein Tzuvesi, is coming to teach us it's Ma'akev. The Gemara is going to discuss, what about the other times in the Torah it says, Kichein Tzuvesi? It also must be teaching us something. What's it teaching us there? Tanu Rabbanon, we see that Bryce is going to bring three places where it says something similar to Kichein Tzuvesi. Tanu Rabbanon, Kichein Tzavisi, that's one pasuk in Parashas Shmini, Kichein Tzuvesi actually it says, and then it says again in Parashas Shmini, Kasha Tzivesi, and again it says later on in Parashas Shmini, Kasha Tziva Hashem, three times where it says Kasha Tziva, Kichein Tzivesi, what's it coming to teach us? Says the Braisa, Kichein Tzuvesi, when it says Kichein Tzuvesi, is talking about Baninus Yechluhu. Was saying, do what I told you, even when you're an Oinon. Because there in Parashas Shmini, we're talking about the Rosh Chodesh Nisan, which was actually the first day, not like the 7 days of Miluim, where the whole process was repeated for all 7 days, and actually done by Moshe Rabbeinu. It was Aaron HaKohen's Korbonis, but the Avodah was done by Moshe Rabbeinu. The first time that Aaron HaKohen would do the Avodah would be on the Rosh Chodesh Nisan. So it says there, do the Avodah of Rosh Chodesh Nisan, the Yom Shmini Lemiluim, and Ba'aninus Yechlu. You should eat the Korbonis even if you're an Oinon. As we know, unfortunately, Nadav and Avihu, the two sons of Aaron, passed away on that Rosh Chodesh Nisan, and he was supposed to eat the Korbonis, even Ba'aninus. So that's what it comes to say, Kichein Tzuvesi, even as an Oinon. When it says, Kasher Tzivesi, B'shas Maisa. When it says there that, as I told you initially, that you should have eaten it, Baninos, and Moshe Rabbeinu was complaining, why did you burn the korban? Why didn't you eat the korban as I told you back then that you should have? B'shas Maisa Omar Lehem, Kasha, Moshe Rabbeinu told them then that you should have eaten it. Kasha Tzivolahem, what he was telling him then was, by the Chazei Atnufa and the Shoi Katruma, the Psukim there, V'loyim Me'ilayan Yoimir, saying to him that you should trust and assume that everything I told you till now, Moshe is telling Aaron, was told exactly by Hashem, and Hashem told you you should eat the korbanos and make sure that the korbanos that you eat, you're supposed to eat, you eat, and you don't do to the other korbanos what you did to the soyer of Rosh Chodesh, that Aaron HaKohen actually burnt that korban of the soyer of Rosh Chodesh and didn't eat it. And Moshe got upset with Aaron, why didn't you eat it, even though you're an oinon? I told you that you're supposed to eat the korbanos. And there was a misunderstanding there, because the korban of Rosh Chodesh wasn't unique to the miluim, and therefore Aaron HaKohen understood that that korban has the regular halachas, then oinon cannot eat it. It's not a discussion we have to go into now, exactly what happened there, or why Aaron HaKohen burnt the soyer of Rosh Chodesh. But the three times it says in that context, Kasha Tzuvesi, is to teach us that there was a whole dialogue there, and Moshe Rabbeinu making sure that Aaron would get the message clearly that the korbanos he was supposed to eat, he was supposed to eat even as an oinon. Continues the Gemara. Omer Rabbi Yosi bar Chanina, Michnosayim ein ksuvim beparsha. In this parasha of Miluim, which as we've mentioned is twice, once in Parashas Tetzaveh, once in Parashas Tzav, in both of those parashas it speaks about the clothes which Aaron HaKohen would wear and which his sons would wear. Aaron HaKohen, being the Kohen Gadol, would have eight clothes. His sons, being Kohen Hediots, would wear only four clothes. And it lists out there that Moshe was told, you should clothe Aaron and you should clothe his children. And in the clothes there mentioned, the michnasayim, in America we call them pants, in England they're called the trousers, but the michnasayim ain't ksuvim b'parasha, they're totally not mentioned in this parasha at all. So where do you know at all that they had to wear them? Keshu'oimer, the very first word in Parashas Tetzaveh, what does it say? V'zeh hadovah shetas olem, the following you should do, and this would be the inauguration of the kuhuna, the avoida, the mishkan. When it says the v'zeh, it starts with the vov. Vov is a continuation, is a connection to what it said previously. V'zeh shetas olem l'kadish oisom l'chayin li. What's the v'? It's saying a continuation to what we said in the parasha before. Lahovi michnasayim, to teach us that they would also have to wear the michnasayim, v'asiris ha'efa, and bring the asiris ha'efa, which is mentioned earlier in that parasha. Says the Gemara, bishleim michnasayim ksiva b'inyonad b'godim, el asiris ha'efa minolon. If you look in the Chumash, you'll see that the michnasayim are actually mentioned in the parasha before, but the asiris ha'efa, that's not mentioned in the parasha before. So how are you seeing from here? How's Rabbi Yosi bar Chanina understanding from the v'zeh that they have to bring this mincha of asiris ha'efa? Says the Gemara, asya zeh zeh, it's a gzera shava. It says in the pasuk, v'zeh korban aron vonov ashi yakrivu l'ashem b'yoymi moshach oisei. It's a pasuk much earlier that says that on the first time when Aaron HaKohen, where any Kohen does the Avoida, he has to bring this Asiris Ha'efa. And since it says Zeh over there, and it says over here V'zeh Adovar, it's coming to teach us that here too, even though it's not mentioned in the parasha of Miluim, that this Asiris Ha'efa had to be brought. Continues the Gemara. Another detail which is mentioned in Parashas Tzav, and Rabbi Yochanan is going to determine that it was Makiv, Omer Rabbi Yochanan Mishum Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai, Menayin She'af Mikra Parasha, that Moshe Rabbeinu was told at the beginning of this parasha, Parashas Tzav, Shmois Perik Ches, to kach es Aaron Resbonov, etc. Ve'es kolo eido hakel, you should gather the whole community, the whole of Klal Yisrael, el Pesach el Moed, to the entrance of the Mishkan. Ve'yas Moshe kash etziva Hashem oisoi, v'tiko elo eido, and he gathered the whole congregation, the whole tzibur of Klal Yisrael were gathered there. Why did Hashem tell Moshe to do that? In order that Moshe should read to them and tell them that everything that I and Aaron HaKohen are going to do and his sons for the next 7 days of Miluim, these are the psukim in Parashas Tetzaveh that Hashem commanded me, this is what's going to happen. The question now is, was it Ma'akov that Moshe actually reads this parasha to Klal Yisrael? Says Rabbi Yochanan, Rishon Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai, Minayin she'af mikro parashim akiv, Talmud Lema, since it says in that posuk, Vayeime Moshe el ha'eido, Zeh adova she'tzivu Hashem la'asois, this is the dover, these are the things which Hashem told me to do. The word dover is not only the things, these are the words. These are the words that Hashem told me to relate to you. Afilu dibur ma'akev, even saying of those words was ma'akev. Continues the Gemara. Ketzad hilbisham. What was the order of the way that Moshe Rabbeinu would dress, would clothe Aaron and his children? Because we know, and this is mentioned also in Parshas Tetzaveh, also in Parshas Tzav, that Moshe was the one that was responsible for clothing, for putting the, or helping the Aaron Ubonov put their clothes on. Whether Moshe helped them with the Michnesayim as well, which are not mentioned in the parasha, is a discussion in the Mefarshim. Rashi seems to say that Moshe did help them, but it's not so clear. The question is, those clothes that are mentioned in the parasha, which are the three other clothes of the Kohen Hediot, of the sons of Aaron, and the seven other clothes of Aaron HaKohen, and Moshe would put them on. Now, it's clear that Moshe would first put the clothes on Aaron and then on his children. The question is, did he do it clothe by clothe, one clothes on Aaron and then those that were parallel, the same with his sons, back to Aaron, back to the sons, or no? Did he put all the clothes on Aaron HaKohen and only then go to the sons? That's going to be the discussion. And we're going to see that the truth is that it's clear that Moshe put all the clothes on Aaron first, besides for the avnet, the belt, which is the question. That's the discussion. And only after he put all those clothes on Aaron, he put all the clothes onto the onto the children, besides for the avnet, besides for the belt. And then the question was, when it came to the belt, where was that? Was the belt also put on Aaron together with the other clothes before putting the clothes on his sons? Or no? Did he first dress the sons the other clothes and then go back to Aaron and put the belt on him and then put the belt on the sons? That's a discussion. And the room for discussion is actually a seeming type of discrepancy between what it says in Parashas Tetzaveh and what it says in Parashas Tzav. What does it say in Parashas Tetzaveh? In Parshas Tetzaveh it says in Posuk Hey, Velokachto es habegodim, you should take the clothes, Velbashto es Aaron, ves Aaron, you should dress Aaron, es hakuson, kusoines, it starts with the kusoines, and which is the shirt, the me'il, the ephod, the choshen, and then the mitznefes, which was the hat that the Kohen Gadol would wear, and then the tzitz, nezer ha-kodesh ala mitznefes, those were the clothes of Aaron. That's what it says first, that Moshe will dress Aaron all the clothes, and interestingly, the belt is not mentioned in the list. And then it says, a couple of psukim later, vezbon of takriv, you should bring close the sons, vilbashtem kutonis, and you should dress them as well. And then v'chogarta oisom, it says after everything, it says that you should gird the Aaron Ubonov with the belts. V'chovashto lemigbois, and put the hats on the children. So there the posuk doesn't mention the belts with the other clothes of Aaron HaKohen. So it would seem from there that the belt was done independently. After he dressed the sons, the other clothes, he would then put the belt on Aaron and the sons. That's what it seems in Parashas Tetzaveh. But let's now move to Parashas Tzav. What does it say in Tzav? It says that Moshe would bring Aaron Ubonov, they would go into the mikveh, v'yitein olov es hakusonis, Moshe would put onto Aaron the kusoines, v'yachkir oisei ba'avnoit, and they would put his belt on, v'yalbish oisei, the me'il, and the ephod, and the choshen, etc., and the mitznefes, and the tzitz. That means that he would dress Aaron, including the avnet. And then a few psukim later, v'yakriv moishes b'nei Aaron, he would then bring the sons of Aaron, v'yalbishim ksoines, v'yakriv isom avnet, and then he would dress them, including the belt. So there the belt is so to speak, mentioned independently with the clothes of Aaron, and then again with the clothes of the sons. In contrast to Parashas Tetzaveh, where there it's not mentioned with Aaron HaKohen, it just says at the end, V'chagarta oisom avnet Aaron ubonov, that he would put the belts on Aaron uvonov. That's going to be a discussion here. But let's see the Gemara. Ketzat el bisham, how did Moshe Rabbeinu dress Aaron uvonov? Says the Gemara, Ketzat el bisham? Interesting question. Maida hava hava, what's the difference? Whatever was. We're trying to learn the mitzvah of Limud HaTorah. What's the relevance to know what Moshe Rabbeinu did back then? Says the Gemara, you're right. Elokeitzad malbishon osid lovi. We assume that the same is going to apply. Osid lovi mitzvah Hashem, we're going to rebuild the Beis Hamikdash, and there's going to be Moshe and Aaron uvonov, and we want to know what's going to be then. That's not history. That's the mitzvah Hashem, something in real reality, hopefully real soon. Says the Gemara, you want to know what's going to happen then? La'osid lovei nami, l'kashe yavoyu, Aaron uvonov u'Moshe imoen, v'yomer, there, you'll wait, whatever will be. Moshe will be then, Aaron and his sons will be then, whatever they'll do, they'll do. What's the issue? Why do you need to know? Why do you, learner, why do we need to know this? Elo says the Gemara, Keta til bisham l'mizbar kroi. I need to know how to understand the seeming discrepancy in psukim. It's not about it. What bothers me less is what happened as to what does it mean, what does the Torah mean? There's a mitzvah to understand every word in the Torah. Why the Torah wrote it doesn't have to, that doesn't have to bother us. We have to understand every word it says in the Torah. And we see here in Parashas Tetzaveh, the Avnet of Aaron is mentioned only together with his sons. In Parashas Tzav, the Avnet is mentioned independently with his own clothes. How do we understand the seeming discrepancy in the Psukim? Says the Gemara, Pligi bo b'nei Reb Chiya v'Reb Yochanan. The sons of Reb Chiya and Reb Yochanan actually argued in how to understand this. Chad Omar once said, Aaron v'achar kach bonov. One of the two opinions understood, as is apparent in the parasha of Tzav, that first Moshe, he dressed Aaron with all the clothes, including the belt, and only afterwards he dressed the sons with their clothes and the belt. V'chad Omar, the other opinion, says, no, let's look at Parashas Tetzaveh. Aaron uvonov b'vas achas. After dressing Aaron with the other clothes, and dressing the children with the other clothes, he would then, together, dress, put on the belt on Aaron, and the belt on the sons. That's the machleikas of Chiyan Rabbi Yechanan. And that's the way that I've explained it. It's not really the words they say. The words they say is just, one says, Aaron first and then the sons, and the other opinion says Aaron and the sons together. But I've explained it based on what the Gemara is going to say in a couple of moments. Says Abaya, B'ksoyne sumit snefes, by all the other clothes, kule alma le pligi, everyone agrees, the Aaron, first Moshe put onto Aaron all the other clothes, v'char kach bonov, and then he put all the other clothes on his sons. The bein b'tzava, both in the parasha where Moshe Rabbeinu was commanded, parashas Tetzaveh, Ubein ba'asiyah, and both in the parasha where the Torah relates what actually happened, parashas Tzav, Aaron kodim. Moshe first put the clothes on Aaron and then on the children. Ki pligi, what's the machlekas? Ba'avnet, only regarding the belt. Mando ma Aaron v'achar kach bonov, the one that says first Aaron put on the belt and then, that means Aaron put on the belt together with his clothes and then the children put the belt on, Moshe Rabbeinu helped them, but Moshe put the belt on the children, that Aaron v'achar kach bonov tichsiv, because they're looking at the parasha on parasha's tzav, and there it says v'yachkar oisei ba'avnit. First, Moshe girded Aaron with his belt. V'hadukhsiv, and then a few psukim later it says v'yachkar oisam avnit, he girded the children with the belt, as we saw in parasha's tzav. Uman do'ama, the other opinion, who says Aaron bonov b'vas achas, that Moshe put the belt of Aaron and the children on together without putting on any other clothes in between. Dechsiv, they were going to parashas Tetzaveh, and there it says v'chogar to'isam. There the pasuk says v'chogar to'isam avnet Aaron ubonov together. So now the Gemara is saying ulamando Omar, according to the opinion that is, so to speak, assumes that what actually happened is what it says in parashas Tetzaveh. Lemando am Aaron uvonov b'vas achas, because it says there just at the end v'chogar to'isam avnet Aaron ubonov. Hoksiv, what are you going to do with the fact that in Parashas Tzav, there it says, V'yachkar oisei ba'avnet. First, Moshe, it seems first, but it's mentioned that Moshe girded Aaron with his belt. V'hadar ksiv, and then the pasuk later says, V'yachkar oisei ba'avnet, he girded the sons with the belt. How is we going to understand Parashas Tzav? Omar lecha hahu avneito shel kohen gadol lo yizehu avneito shel kohen hedyot. The reason the pasuk singles out the avnate of Aaron and the avnate of the sons is not to tell you the sequence that you should learn from Parashas Tetzaveh, just to tell you that it was a different type of belt. The belt of the Kohen Gadol had shatnezin. The belt of the Kohen Hedyot didn't have shatnezin. It's a different type of belt. That's all the Pasuk is trying to impress on us. And according to the other opinion who says that what actually happened, the sequence, the order was what it says in Parashas Tzav, which first Moshe put all the clothes on Aaron, including his belt, and then he put all the clothes on his children with the belt. V'oksiv, how are you going to understand the Pasuk in Parashas Tzaveh, v'chogar ta'oysam avnit? Exactly the same idea, but the opposite opinion of what we saw before. What actually happened was what it says in Parashas Tzav. The reason that in Parashas Tzav it puts the two together to impress on us that this opinion holds, that V'chogar ta'oysam avneit Aaron Avonov, is to teach us that the belt was the same belt that the Kohen Gadol wore as the Kohen Hedyot. They both wore the same type of belt. They both had shatnas. In order to impress that on us, in Parashas Tetzaveh, it says, Vayachkar oysam avneit Aaron Avonov. Vayachkar oysay avneit, Vayachkar oysam lomoli. And the fact that in Parashas Tzav, and some say these words are superfluous, but the fact that in Parashas Tzav, it first says, Vayachkar oysay bavneit, and then it says, Vayachkar oysam, that according to this opinion is Shema Minot, to teach us Aaron Vacharkach Bonov. Because according to this opinion, Parashas Tzav is teaching us the sequence of what actually happened. First, he put the belt on Aaron with the rest of his clothes, and then the belt on the sons with the rest of their clothes. Says the Gemara. And I've explained the Gemara to you in the way that the Gemara is the conclusion of the Gemara. But the term used all the time is bevas achas, together, simultaneously. So I explained what it means is that simultaneously means that first he put all the other clothes on Aaron, then all the other clothes on the sons, and then the belts were put on together, first Aaron and then the children. And that's according to that opinion. That's if you follow the parasha of Parashas Tetzaveh. If you follow Parashas Tzav, then it wasn't done together. Aaron's belt was put on together with the rest of his clothes, and the children's belt was put on together with the rest of their clothes. However, the term Bevas Acha seems to be at the same time, as if according to the opinion that says that the sequence of events was the way it seems in Parashas Tetzaveh, that V'chogar Ta'oysam Avneit Aaron Abonov, that both of them put the belt on together, it would seem as if Moshe Rabbeinu girded all five of them, Aaron HaKohen and his four sons, with their belts at the same time. That doesn't make sense. Ubevas achas mi meshkachas lo, is it possible to put belts on five people at the same time? Says the Gemara, lo yitzricha da'aktim. What it actually means is the way we explained it all along. Of course Aaron was first. The question is not doing it at the same moment. The question is in order. Did he put the belts, all the belts on one after the other, first Aaron's belt and then the children's belt, but after Aaron and the children had already been clothed with all the other clothes, or were they not done one after the other? It was actually done with an interruption. First Aaron's clothes were put on, including the belt, and then all the other clothes of the children were put on between the belt of Aaron being put on Aaron and the belt of the children being put on the children. They put on their other clothes. That's called not bevas achas. And in Mirtz Hashem, in the next shir, we're going to continue from here.